The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one I call Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of it being 3 weeks since Storm Babet, whether it will provide an update on the support that is being made available to the affected communities in Angus, Aberdeenshire and Dundee.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Local recovery partnerships have been working hard to support affected communities across the country, and the Scottish Government has been fully supporting that work, particularly around maintaining access and restoring transport routes. The Government moved at pace to activate the Belwyn scheme and is working with local authorities on their claims. The Scottish Welfare Fund is also available to help families and people in Scotland through crisis grants and community care grants. Ministers have already met to discuss how the Scottish Government can further support the recovery process, and with the first meeting of the Ministerial Task Force taking place on Thursday, we'll seek to encourage cooperation between local recovery groups and coordinate Scottish Government actions where they may support locally led recovery efforts. More broadly, we are working with local groups to establish what exactly is required. We have already provided £150 million on top of our long-standing £42 million in annual flooding support for flood risk management, in addition to £12 million to coastal change adaptation over the course of this Parliament.
Tess White.
Minister, the SNP Government seems to find money at the drop of a hat for pet projects, but not for the people of Brechin. In the town, 60 council houses and 20 housing association homes need major repairs. 45 static caravans and park homes have been damaged, while countless owner-occupiers in Brechin, Fernarvon and Tannadice are facing massive repair bills. Businesses such as Brechin Castle Centre are losing as much as £100,000. Meanwhile, Angus Council is scraping the barrel from its own reserves. 3 weeks on from Storm Babet, they simply want to know what financial support are they going to get from the Scottish Government and when?
Minister.
Well, as I outlined in my original answer, we moved at pace to activate the Belwyn scheme, which is in place exactly for these types of circumstances. But as the First Minister stated in his visit to Brechin last month, we recognise the unprecedented nature of these events, that the repair and recovery will be a long-haul endeavour, and the Government will be there for the long haul to support these communities. So we are engaging closely with our colleagues in local government to ensure that the support that is required is clearly identified, and we stand willing and ready to work in partnership with local government to ensure that support is delivered.
Tess White.
Minister, over the last 48 hours, Storm Debbie brought another weather warning and more anxiety for residents and businesses. Shockingly, the ministerial task force you mentioned is meeting on Thursday. That's 4 weeks. Time marches on. This ministerial task force should have met weeks ago to look at recovery and assess ongoing flood risk. What urgent action is the Scottish Government taking with partners such as SEPA to reassess the flood risk and reassure residents that they're safe as more storms loom large on the horizon? Thank you.
Minister.
I would want to reassure the member that the Deputy First Minister led engagement with ministerial colleagues last month, and that the ministerial task force will be meeting on Thursday, and this will supplement and complement the efforts that are already underway and have been underway since last month, and we will continue to engage with our local government partners on the ground. More broadly, on the issues of mitigation and adaptation, this Government is taking a range of actions in recognition of the impact that climate change will have upon the weather environment in which we operate. That is reflected both in hard money through capital investment, support for local government, working in partnership to deliver resilience and flood improvements. It's also reflected in our regulatory environment, not least in what we took forward in the National Planning Framework for. But as I said previously, we recognise the unprecedented nature of these events, the scale of what is required to support recovery, and we're committed to working in partnership with our local government colleagues to deliver that.
John Swinney.
President Officer, given the severity of the impact of Storm Babet on Angus, Aberdeenshire, Dundee, and also in my own constituency in Perthshire. Does the Minister recognise the concern and alarm that members of the public feel about the extremity of the weather conditions that we are now experiencing, which my constituency again yesterday took very serious impacts as a consequence of these effects? Will the Government, as a consequence of that recognition, acknowledge the importance of taking speedy action in relation to climate mitigation measures, because the hard choices that we have to make as a society cannot be avoided as a consequence of the frequency of the incidents that we are experiencing, of which there have been many since the events of early October, with severe effects on our communities? And will the Government prioritise that climate action to protect members of the public?
Minister.
I can confirm that to the member. I think it's an extremely important point, and we must recognise, as well as the moral imperative towards future generations for work on adaptation and mitigation of climate change. Climate change is with us in the here and now, and that requires not just to take action across our regulatory environment and support we provide for measures such as flood defences, but also underscores the need for the way in which we respond to crises to develop and to ensure that we can provide rapid support. And that is why there is a ministerial task force being convened, and why there is a significant investment that the Government is bringing forward to support flood defences across Scotland. And it is why, and I would reiterate this point, we are absolutely committed to be there for the long haul for those communities that have been impacted by the events of Storm Babet, to ensure that a full recovery is achieved.
Thank you. And question number two, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to a Unison survey that reportedly shows a 31% increase in the number of violent incidents against public sector workers in the last year.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. All workers, including public sector workers, deserve protection from abuse and violence. The courts have extensive powers to deal robustly with assaults, and sentences all the way up to life imprisonment are available. We fully support the courts having these powers and would encourage reporting of incidents to Police Scotland. The Unison survey referenced by Katie Clark highlights incidents, particularly in schools and nurseries. And at this stage, I must declare an interest, as my wife is a local authority teacher and equity officer. So the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills has recently chaired two stages of a Relationships and Behaviour in Schools Summit to ensure that schools are safe for pupils, teachers and support staff. And the third stage of that summit is due to take place later this month.
Katie Clark.
Thank you. This Unison research shows nearly 55,000 violent incidents against public sector staff recorded last year, a 31% increase from the previous year. However, many parts of the public sector, such as some of the big health boards, did not provide data. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that all parts of the public sector need to cooperate so we can get the best information to address these serious problems?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I appreciate Katie Clark's question there. I think it is important. First of all, responding to FOI requests is a matter for each public authority to respond on. However, understanding the extent of violent incidents is an important aspect of being able to respond to the issue, and it's important information in this area. It's important that it is made available so everyone can understand the extent of the problems.
Katie Clark.
The Cabinet Secretary specifically referred to problems in schools, and the research showed 35,000 verbal and physical attacks on council staff. The majority occurred in schools, mostly against support staff. Can the Minister maybe outline more fully what support is being put into schools and what resources can be made available to address this problem?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Obviously, this is an issue that has been worked upon by the Cabinet Secretary, my colleague Ms Gilruth, around the work that is ongoing with that particular task force, and the third iteration of it, as I said in my original response, is due to take place later this month, the conclusions upon which I expect will be set out thereafter. An additional point of reference for Katie Clark is the First Minister and myself will be meeting with the SDUC for our annual biannual meeting, our biannual meeting this week, where I expect some of this will be discussed in more depth.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recently, Fife Council appeared to vote through a policy under which bullies and those who assault our teachers in schools, which I share the Minister's concern on, may not be punished. So is the Minister supportive of that move, and what impact does the Minister think it might have on public sector worker victims?
Cabinet Secretary.
Obviously, we cannot tolerate abusive behaviour towards staff, support staff, other pupils, including bullying. And we will continue to provide targeted education programmes for our young people on the risks of violence and the effects of violence as a whole. We and partners across the education sector advocate an approach for schools and local authorities to work with pupils on the underlying reasons behind such inappropriate behaviours. And we want all pupils to respect their peers and staff, and are supporting a number of programmes to promote positive relationships and tackle indiscipline, abuse and violence. So this includes good behaviour management, restorative approaches and programmes to help develop social, emotional and behavioural skills. And again, this is work that is ongoing with the Cabinet Secretary on ensuring behaviour in schools continues to be targeted and is appropriate.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.